All right, all right, all right, all right. Back in the action once again. It's about that time of day again here, folks. Time to get back to work. It's Thursday afternoon. It is November 21st, 2019. My name is Joseph. And as always, welcome back to your nightly newsletter. Now, if you're here for the first time, it's great to have you with me here this evening because I help traders find high-quality trade setups using a very simple three-step strategy that we teach and trade together every morning in our trade room. But my job tonight is a little bit different. My job tonight is to help you guys and gals find the best levels of support and resistance for tomorrow, the best entry and exit setups for tomorrow, and most importantly, how can I forget, my job tonight is to help you guys and gals avoid all those common traps waiting for you on Friday morning. And of course, we got a lot to cover here tonight on the video. We'll grab the calendar first tomorrow. We'll check the news schedule here for tomorrow morning at a finally Friday session we're planning for tomorrow. Then we'll grab some charts. We got a lot to cover tonight on the charts. We got some oil, some S&P, some Nasdaq, and of course some gold. I'm going to jump in here first though to the black gold, the Texas T, the crude oil futures, because you might have noticed oil just kept on going. We all can see direction here on crude oil right now. Let's grab that crude chart. Let's get this party rolling here tonight. I don't think there's any question about what's going on right now, right? We heard from Russia and OPEC earlier this week. They're talking about production cuts as we go into 2020, trying to keep these prices towards the $50 a barrel rather than towards the $50 a barrel. I can't say I don't blame them. So, of course, they've been fanning the flames this week, getting this market running higher. And it's pretty easy to see we're definitely bullish. But there's one thing that we haven't seen yet, and that is a nice deep pullback. We got that little trap, right, we talked about in last night's newsletter. But for the most part, though, besides really small, little shallow pullbacks, we haven't seen much of a deep, deep pullback to let all the real traders get in, right, for a nice move up here. So that's really what I'm waiting for here tomorrow. I would anticipate tomorrow, because anytime I see a market that goes this far without much of a pullback, buyers are eventually going to run out of, dare I say, gas, right? They're going to run out of fuel up here. And usually what happens is a market will either go sideways into a range up top here, or we'll get one of those sharp, sharp pullbacks. And these are really the two scenarios that tonight on the video we're going to get ready for. So I'm going to talk about range-bound markets. Got a bunch of those tonight. We'll talk about what to expect tomorrow if the market turns sideways for a range. I got a bunch of really reliable patterns we'll talk about on that tonight. But really, let's be honest, what I want is I want a deep pullback. I got a couple levels here I'm watching right now for those pullbacks, 35 area, the 92 area. And really tonight, I'll talk about some different types of pullbacks and how to use momentum to really kind of pre-qualify which type of entry setup that you want to use on that pullback. We'll also talk about what if this market keeps going higher, because that $60 a barrel is only a couple legs higher here. So we'll talk about as the market goes higher here as well. If you're an oil trader, tomorrow could be an interesting day tomorrow on the oil. And we're going to break this thing down into bite-sized pieces for tonight on the video. Over on the S&P 500, boy, if there could be polar opposites, right? This is a complete opposite market. The oil was just up, 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 up. And today, of course, the S&P and the Nasdaq, you'll see in a moment, is pretty much running sideways. This is a range-bound market on oil, or on the S&P here right now. Range-bound market, what's a range tell us to do? A range tells us to buy low, it tells us to sell high, and it tells us to avoid the middle. So I've got my buy zones down below, I've got my sell zones up above. I want to get short up above those highs. I want to get long right down underneath those lows. We'll talk about the specific buy and sell setups I'm looking for to actually get into those positions tomorrow. And obviously, with 2 days right now running sideways here on the S&P, tomorrow might be the day for a breakout. We'll talk about what a breakout looks like, because as you can see, All the attempted breakouts so far have been a little bit less than successful, right? Even those strong ones that we saw earlier, right, in the day today. So we definitely know breakouts are not going to be too easy, but I've got a very easy plan tomorrow to qualify and capitalize on the right breakout patterns. If you're an S&P trader like I am, you definitely want to stay tuned for more on that for the video tonight. How about some Nasdaq? Nasdaq is very similar to the S&P. In fact, a lot of this will be kind of an overlap between these two markets. It's a range-bound market here right now. Range, of course, tells me buy low. It tells me sell high. I want to sell up above that range. I want to buy underneath the range. I've got some really interesting levels here, right? These expanding triangles. You know what I always say, right? The year of 2019, right, is the year of the expanding triangle on the E-minis. And we'll talk about how to use those expanding triangles. Because as you can see, being a buyer off the low is going to be a little bit different than being a seller off the high. That move off the high is pretty darn big. So we'll talk about the right way to stay out of trouble buying low and selling high on the Nasdaq tomorrow. And again, tomorrow might be the day we get that breakout. We'll talk about breakouts, the ways to get in, and where to get out of those breakout patterns. Last but not least here, of course, we'll talk about the gold tonight. Gold, the yellow metal. Boy, quite the choppy marketplace. Now, at first glance, I thought, boy, they've really broken free of this trading range. But after a little bit more digging into this, it looks like the gold's just been trying to get themselves out of the way of this falling resistance. You'll notice, right, there's some resistance, right, coming down here right now. The bottom line is we know the gold is range-bound. Range-bound markets, again, they tell us to buy low. They tell us to sell high. And tonight what I'll do is we'll talk about how to buy off that low, how to sell off of that high. I've got a really good clue here right now telling me that we might be ready for that move going back up into that trading range. But again, I think the biggest problem here has been these trend lines coming down. What's the best pattern for me to be a buyer and avoid that trend line, right? We haven't seen it yet. We haven't seen it yet, and that's probably why this market keeps grinding lower here. I'm going to talk about the best way to trade this gold to buy up off of that low, or if we do make a run lower, right? What if this thing does continue and we make a nosedive going lower? We'll talk about how to trade that breakout as well. So as you can see, we're ready to rock and roll here. Get the charts all prepped up. Gold is here. I got my buddy Nasdaq. My boy S&P here is here, right? And crude oil is all ready to go for us as well. Before we jump into the video tonight, though, I always want to make sure to remind you to make sure you join our mailing list. You may not be aware of this, but just before I publish this video, I send out an email to everybody on our mailing list, and I want to make sure you get that email so you know exactly when this nightly newsletter goes live. So don't delay on this one. Make sure you join our mailing list here this evening. All I need is your name, your email address, and then hit that subscribe now button, right, and join our mailing list. Now, a heads up, when you hit that subscribe button, your job isn't over yet. You still need to go into your email inbox and check for that welcome email. I'm going to send you a welcome email when you register for our mailing list. And I'll tell you, sometimes that welcome email, it gets stuck in your spam folder. You got to find that welcome email in there, right? Because in that welcome email is a bunch of great free resources so you and I can get the most out of our time together. But more importantly, there's a verification link in that welcome email, and that welcome email will put you onto my list, right? So make sure you check your email and check that spam folder, right, if it's not in your inbox. And if it is in your spam folder, make sure you add us to your safe senders list, your white list, and let me know if you guys have any trouble along the way on that. And then, as always, I'm always excited to answer all those questions. What questions, comments, concerns, feedback do you have, right? Do you have any questions about anything we talk about in tonight's video? That's what the comment section's for. So definitely don't forget, right, use that comment section at any time during this video. If you have any questions, if you have any feedback, anytime you want me to do more of something, let me know. You know, I'm not a mind reader. I'm a pretty good trader, right? I'm a pretty good teacher, but I definitely can't read minds. So if it's something I can make better that will help you become a better trader, I want to know more about it. How can I improve this video newsletter so you are always improving as a trader? Drop me some feedback in the comment section below. And again, throughout this video tonight, right, if you have any questions on the way, drop those comments in and I'll be happy to answer them in the comment section below. And also too, don't forget, while you're down in the comment section, do me a big favor, will you? Hit that thumbs up button for me. I'll tell you every time you hit hit that thumbs up button. Not only does it give me more energy to keep making these videos for you, but it helps to expose this video to more traders who would love to learn this trading strategy as well. So don't delay, guys. Post those questions and comments in the comments section below. And while you're down there, hit that thumbs up button for me. It goes a long way with me, right, and to help me grow this YouTube channel. So I always appreciate you guys to help me out there down with that thumbs up button. And don't forget, guys, if you have any questions at all, right, maybe you don't want to type them into the comments section, you can always call me in the office. I'm always here. Call that toll-free phone number in the upper right-hand corner, and I would love to talk to you, answer all your questions. I'm old school, right? I actually talk on the telephone. So if you have any questions, please feel free to pick up that telephone and call me anytime you guys have any questions. I'll be waiting for your call right here in the office in our headquarters in Los Angeles. In the meantime, let's get this party rolling here. Let's start off first by checking the schedule here for tomorrow, courtesy of the Econo Day Economic News Calendar. Of course, Friday, November the 22nd on our radar tomorrow. Tomorrow is a Friday. Fridays are always early in, early out trading sessions. And of course, that means you've really got to have a good reason to be trading after lunchtime, right, tomorrow morning. My go-to time on Friday mornings is usually between about 8 o'clock and 10:30 Eastern time. Sometimes we get some good setups a little bit later in the morning, but usually on a Friday morning between 8 o'clock and 10:30 Eastern time is where you're going to get the meat and potatoes, as I always say, the good stuff, right, out of these markets. And again, I don't want to say you can't trade after 10:30 or after lunch on a Friday afternoon, but just beware, right? Just beware, the later the day gets on a Friday, the more desperate the traders get, right? I mean, nobody, trust me, if you have a choice, you're taking off Friday afternoon, right? So the people who are still trading on Fridays are usually going to be what? The desperate traders out there. And markets tend to be a lot more painful to trade during those Friday afternoons. I remember my mom told me when I was a kid, nothing good happens after midnight. You know, nothing good happens after midnight. Same thing goes, right? Not a lot of good. I don't want to say nothing, but not a lot of good happens after 11 o'clock on Friday morning. So early in, early out, right? Careful, careful after 11 o'clock on Friday morning. And don't forget, we're going to be trading that sweet spot together and every morning, right? 8 o'clock Eastern time in our trade room. So make sure you come out and do it with me tomorrow morning, right, along with us. As you can see, there's not a lot of news on the schedule here tomorrow, right? There's not a lot of news on the schedule there tomorrow. So really, tomorrow is a wide open day. We are continuing to hear from OPEC. We continue to hear about Brexit. We continue to hear, dare I say, trade and the U.S. and China, right? Trade talks. I know that word trade has quickly become a four-letter word in most of our vocabularies, right? I know, I promise. I won't say any more of it here tonight. But again, those are kind of the known unknowns here for tomorrow, right? We may get a headline, you know, mid-morning about trade. We may have some stuff happening overnight regarding OPEC, right, or Brexit. These are some known unknowns right now. So even though we don't have any scheduled news for tomorrow, you know, this is a little consumer sentiment number there at 10 o'clock Eastern time. You know, there's really nothing major on the calendar, which means any big headline regarding the trade talks, any big headline regarding the OPEC production cuts, any big headline, right, about Brexit here will likely be a catalyst for these markets. Now, as always, I remind you, we do not trade these headlines. Okay, make sure you're very aware of that. We are not news traders, right? Most news traders are soon to be broke traders. We trade the reaction to those headlines, right? I have a live news feed in the trade room. Headlines come out. We wait for the reaction and we trade the reaction. I would caution you, right, against trading during any news or headlines, right, that come out tomorrow as well. And again, right, again, come out and join us tomorrow every morning and we'll do it together the right way. That way you don't need to stress out and lose a lot of money and try to do this all on your own. So tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock Eastern time, I'll plan on seeing you there with us. Let's jump into some charts here tonight. We got some oil, some S&P, NASDAQ, and we might just find some time here for that yellow metal, that gold futures here tonight. Absolutely. Let's jump first, though, into the oil market. Oil is bullish with a capital bullish right now. Very, very bullish. It is fundamentally bullish because, again, we heard from the OPEC report or we heard from OPEC and Russia talking about these kind of coordinated right? Coordinated production cuts, right? In a lot of industries, they would call that what? Price fixing, right? Monopolies, right? So, potato, potato, right? OPEC says production cuts. Most people call it antitrust, but who's paying attention anyways out there? Anyways, bottom line is, right, we have a bullish market on our hands here right now. And again, as I mentioned in the introduction, one of the big things that we haven't seen yet is much of a deep pullback. We got that little, that little shake and bake that we talked about in last night's newsletter, right? We got that little kind of trap, right? And then back up in that small battle zone from last night's newsletter. If you missed that from last night's newsletter, definitely make sure you go back and watch that one. But other than that, though, there hasn't been much of a pullback. So in these situations, I always try to find some way I can buy a deep pullback at a level of support. Right? A real shallow level of support doesn't help me very much right now. I want to find a way to buy low so I can risk small to earn large. And I also would imagine there's a lot of other traders in the market that are really waiting on the sidelines right now. They're waiting for a pullback. They're waiting for something they can get their hands on here, right, as the market pulls back. And that's exactly what my plan is for tomorrow as well. Now, as I mentioned before, we may also go into a range here tomorrow too. So you do want to be aware, right, of what that range may look like. The first thing is, where are some easy levels of support? What I did first is I drew a trend line off these highs and I brought it down to those lows, and boy, does that fit well. This is really the one I really want to get myself into tomorrow. Now, my only concern is it's just so obvious, and a lot of times these really obvious channels, a lot of times they just don't end up working, which is what kind of makes me think we may go higher into a range, but that would be me speculating right now. I don't know any of that. So what I do know is I know we're bullish. I know I want to find a level of support that allows me to get a nice deep pullback. So that low of that channel, right, really fits well. Then you'll also notice, if I zoom in a little bit closer on this, I also drew a trend line off of these two highs, and I brought it off down to that low, and that's kind of given me this small, it's not really smaller, it's just steeper, right? That kind of creates that little envelope you see right there, right? That little kind of, this little wedge you can see there going up like that, right? So that's where that comes from. Those are two channels drawn in. They're almost identical. Now, you could be looking at this saying, well, wait a second, Joe, isn't this a spike in channel, right? This is a spike in channel right there. That is a spike in channel. Pattern goes up, right? Spike in channel. What does a spike in channel tell us? Spike in channel always tells us the base of that channel, right? So that's another support level I like as well. So three support levels here. One of them, right? One of them is this hidden channel, the big one, the big boy, right? The other one is this little, pink one or violet one, right? That creates the kind of envelope there. And then again, what I really think is the powerful spot here is this 92 to 78. Because again, the first thing you think about when you see this chart is, oh, it's a spike in channel, right? We go up, we pull back, we go up. There's your high. There's your spike in channel, right? That's my first instinct is it's a spike in channel. Now, if this was earlier in the trend, as in like yesterday morning, I'd be willing to buy. I'd be definitely interested in buying that pullback. The problem is it's so late in this move, you're asking for trouble. Again, if you want to be an aggressive buyer, you're about a day late on this oil. This is not the time to be an aggressive buyer at all, or an aggressive seller, to be honest with you. We're way too bullish to be selling this. What I need to do is find a nice conservative spot where I can buy a nice deep pullback, where I can then risk small, right? Take a small risk and get a big reward. Because as I always remind you guys on this video, when you can get a small risk for a big potential reward, like I'm drawing up right here, that's a very attractive trade to people, right? Risk small, earn large. What is attractive is very reliable because of the self-fulfilling prophecy. So I really, really like, to kind of go back to where I was talking about earlier, I like a spike in channel here, because what does a spike in channel tell you? A spike in channel says the first pullback and the base of that channel. This spot right there, this is usually where the market will pull back in a spike in channel. It just happens to also line up right at the lows of those two channels. Okay, so now we're looking good. Now we kind of know what area we're watching for as well. Now, I also want to point out too, you've got this huge reversal line here that I think is the big elephant in the room. I think that reversal line, we go up. I mean, heck, we even double topped that thing, right? And then came back. And they net right and then went up. They haven't pulled back to it yet. Okay, these reversal lines, let's put it this way, I'll be very disappointed if we don't get a chance to use that reversal line at some point in the near future, because that level at 40s there, you know, again, 30, what is that, 35? Yeah, 35, you know, 35, 36 area there, that level's a beauty. Okay, anytime you get a nice reversal line that hasn't been hit yet, you know right now there are buyers with their orders, right? Just lined up right there. And as the market comes back, right, they'll fill the orders, right, and probably go right back up to retest the high. So I've definitely got these two areas I'm watching for right now on oil. Let's talk about how to trade them now. Now that we know what we're looking for, let's talk about trading them. As we pull back, right, there are two basic types of pullbacks as we go into that first battle zone down there. One of them is going to be pretty much a straight pullback, right? You know, maybe a little move down, right? But almost a straight pullback. And you'll see why I say straight pullback in a moment here, right? So we pull back down to that low. Once we get that pullback now, there's going to be a lot of traders who are thinking this market is now reversed. Okay, they're not going to see these channels. They're going to try to sell that first pullback to the moving average. Okay, this is where the magic happens. Okay, we saw something similar to it back here. And if you remember from last night's newsletter, there was a reason why we expected to get that little bit of mess right there, right? Remember, that was a falling resistance trend line. Anyways, so if you watch last night's newsletter, we talked about that one right there. But it looked very similar to that, right? It'll pull back below the moving average. The bears will come in and try to sell off the EMA. Now, at that point now, is the market bearish? No, it's not. So the odds are not very good for these bears, right? The odds are definitely not in favor for those bears, and the odds are much better that those sellers fail. And so I want to put myself in their shoes and think, okay, if I was a seller, where would my stop be, right? Where's my stop loss? Where's my, as I always tell my clients, find the pain, right? Where do the counter trend sellers in this case, where do they start to get pinched, right? Where do they start hitting the red? Where do they start waving the white flag, if you will? It's right above that high, and that's exactly where I want to be buying then. So again, I wait for the pullback into my support area. I anticipate that pullback is very strong, and so sellers will try to sell into it, right? They'll sell the pullback themselves. When they do, now their stops are exposed. And because this market is so bullish, anytime we have this much movement in one direction, the odds are stacked in our favor for a move back up to retest that high. I want to buy right into those stop losses. Now, sometimes we get lucky and we get this failure into pullback combination. So I'll definitely be keeping an eye out for that seller failure. It's a failure pattern underneath the moving average, then into a pullback pattern once we get back above it. Okay, now here's something else to consider. We may see some, you know, aggressive buyers here trying to buy off that low here. If we get a two-legged pullback, okay, this is a little bit more tricky, but this one will have two very distinct legs, right? It'll pull back one leg and two leg. In that scenario, guys and gals, let me move this down a little bit there, right? In that scenario here, one and two, now what you want to do is draw that trend line overhead, get above it, and use it as support, right? We call this a two-legged pullback or a 2LP. These are a little bit more advanced, right? Because again, you get to draw that trend line over. And in my experience, the biggest tip I can give you here without giving away too much of our strategy for tomorrow morning, right, is gonna be to get some daylight in between. You know, for example, sometimes the market comes over and it kind of grinds down that trend line. You wanna go up, over, and then pop right off that trend line. Makes sense, right? You want to go up, over, and then pop right off the trend line. I'll call it a two-legged pullback pattern. Okay, perfect. So now we've got three different patterns as I'm waiting now off that pullback. But what if I'm wrong? You know, what if we really run? You know, what if this thing takes a nosedive here, right, and runs overnight down to that 35 level? Right, that big old reversal line that we talked about earlier on in this video. What if we really tumble? If we blow right through that first battle zone, through the low of that channel, what's going to happen now? The bears are going to be really confident. And so I'm not going to be able to use that same, you know, failure and then back up again. That won't be, it just won't be reliable enough. Because what's going to happen is the bears will probably try at least twice before they give up and let me take this thing back up again. Okay, now oftentimes these deep, deep pullbacks lead to this combination. It's called a nested failure. Right, so 1-2 tries, and then oftentimes what happens is because those sellers are so stuck, and when they get out, it becomes a big bull run. It oftentimes runs up, and we get this little trap before we get back to retest the high. Keep your eyes on that one too. Okay, you'll notice this is a very similar little pattern, but because we know where the market's trying to go here, right, I don't want to buy too high, so I buy with that trap low. Does that make sense? Right? So if we really run lower here down to that key 35 level that I mentioned earlier, let those bears try once, let them try twice now, don't get too aggressive on those deep pullbacks, and then once they try twice and fail, bingo. Now we can run it right back up, right? Whoop, and pull the plug and bring it right back up to retest the high. And then again, as it runs higher, because those bears are, or because those bears get smoked and everything runs back up, we oftentimes don't get that little pullback that we usually get off of shallow pullbacks. And because of this, you want to look for what I call a two-try breakout pattern, which in this case is a strong move up, one try for the bears, two try for the bears, and again, little trap. What you really want is the trap. The trap is your way of getting in before you go back up to retest the high. Because if you're trying to buy a pullback up here, right? If you're trying to buy a pullback when it's right around those highs, it's not be very successful. A lot of pullbacks will fail when you get back up to retest the high. A more reliable thing, right? That two try, trap low, and then up we go from there. At that point now, your target, of course, is back to retest the high. You've got that measured move sitting right above you as well. So those are two very easy scenarios. Well, I guess easy is a relative term. I'm going to make it very easy for you tomorrow with me in the trade room. If you're doing it on your own tomorrow, just remember, right, you can always go back and watch this video again to kind of rehearse this before you trade tomorrow morning. The next thing here is I definitely think here that you want to make sure, right, you keep your eyes right now on this range, right? The range will probably be here somewhere tomorrow. At some point, we'll probably see a range, right? Now, what's the goal of a range bound market? Buy low, sell high, and avoid the middle. Now, we don't know enough about the range yet, unfortunately, do we? We don't. We don't know where the range is yet. Once we know where that range is, though, now I can use that range to find my support levels. What I'll do is I'll use the size of that range and I'll bring down my levels from there and I'll create my levels of support underneath that range. And those levels of support, I want to use those levels of support in combination with my favorite range breakout pattern, right? Here's my favorite breakout pattern. My favorite breakout pattern is actually a breakout pattern failure. Because most breakouts fail, right? So when I see a market try to break out, I like to wait for those breakout pullback traders, right? Wait for that breakout pullback to commit and then buy right into those stop losses. Now, keep in mind, right? Keep in mind this channel, okay? Once we get the range, if we do see a range, that channel is no longer a top priority. I want to make that very clear. If we see a range, if it starts going sideways, double tops, double bottoms, that, right, that channel I have drawn on is now, it doesn't disappear, but it's no longer a priority. The most important thing is to make sure we're buying underneath the range. All right? So I don't want you to make that mistake and say, well, right, we went sideways and then we touched the low of the range right there, right? That's not a good spot to be trading. I realize it's the low of the channel, and it might go up, but you're right inside that range, right? The key is, no matter what happens, once we start seeing this thing go sideways, wait for that breakdown. Again, get that moving average coming over, get those sellers to try to sell that breakout pullback, right? And then buy into those stop losses. Now, we may also see, we may also see the market go sideways here and then break out, right? So what does a breakout of a range look like? One, two, three breakout. Mark the high, mark the low, and we'll buy the low of that new hidden channel. As you can see, I don't trust breakouts whatsoever. So if we do go sideways here, I'm not going to even think about touching, right, that first breakout, and I'm certainly not going to trade that breakout pullback. That is a very unreliable pattern. Again, this is all based on if we go sideways here on this thing to be a range. Okay, if it goes sideways, then we see a strong move up, a pullback to the moving average coming over, a strong move off the moving average. Now what I can do is I can use that new hidden channel and buy the low of that channel. Now at this point, my target won't be that much bigger, right? Be up around that measured move, and of course, that $60 a barrel, right, for the runner going higher. Now, last but not least here, how does this market turn bearish? Well, at this point now, we're going to have to see, at the very least, we're going to have to get underneath this battle zone. Have to get a strong move down. We're going to have to hold the pullback and really run. That's the only way I can justify being a seller on this because, you know, even if we do get a strong run down here, I just think you're still going to see those bears probably go right back up again, right? So I don't trust this to the downside unless I see a strong move through the battle zone. Then you've got to show me you mean it, right? Prove to me with what I call a 1-2-3 reversal, right? So one is a strong move against the trend. Two is a pullback to the moving average. And three is that strong move off the moving average. At that point now, we're bearish. I'm going to mark up that low. I'm going to draw a trend line off the new lower lows. I'm going to bring that up to the highs, and that will create my new hidden channel. And we look to sell off the high of that channel. All right, say it with me here. It's a 1-2-3 reversal, 1-2-3 reversal into a hidden channel pullback. 1-2-3 reversal into a hidden channel pullback. Now, where's my target if we go back down again? Boy, if we go back down again, I would imagine one place we may stall out is that $57 a barrel. Okay, the other spot, obviously, is pretty much all the way back down to that 55.5 area. Boy, I doubt that'll be the case tomorrow. If the bears can take this, I would imagine we end up kind of sitting back around that 57. 57, if you're just joining us here this year, 57's been a real popular number all year here on the oil futures. So that is definitely, right, the case here for tomorrow. And of course, right, if we keep going higher, if the market keeps going higher here, not much changes, guys. Right? If we do keep going higher here, wait for that pullback. Wait for those sellers to try to commit, right? Get that stop run and run back up, right? Everyone's waiting on that deep pullback right now. And again, if it really pulls back deep, now you want to go into that, right, that nested 1-2 and then back up from there. So boy, oh boy, we've covered a lot so far, right? We're half an hour already into this video. We've talked about shallow pullbacks, deep pullbacks, range-bound markets, reversals. Boy, I have so much I want to share with you, and I can't put it all in this video tonight. So here's what I want to do. I'll give you access to our free trading classes here at School of Trade. Grab that link in the upper right-hand corner here. I'll also put a big red button for you right below this video on our trading blog. Or, you know, if you're on YouTube right now, grab the link in the upper right-hand corner or grab the description, right? In the description, you'll see all the links there as well. Most important thing, though, is grab the free course, because the free trading course will teach you all my four favorite patterns, my three-step strategy. You'll see how we do things in our trade room. I'll throw you an invite to attend on a free pass, right? You'll get everything you need to really make the most out of our time every evening on this video newsletter. So if you want a deeper dive into all my favorite patterns, my failures, my reversals, my pullbacks, right? Everything we use in our trade room, grab that free course in the upper right-hand corner. Because in the meantime, I'm going to keep moving here. A lot more to cover here tonight on this video. Moving forward now, we got the oil all ready to go here for tomorrow. And you know where to get that free course from in the upper right-hand corner. How about some S&P? S&P is pretty much neutral right now. There's definitely a bearish overall tone in the short term. But, I mean, make no mistake, right? You look left and you can easily see we are, right, coming out of a very big bull run. So I don't, I, I, I I have a very hard time calling this market a bear market right now. Let's put it this way. The most I'll go on the S&P is to say we're neutral. I wouldn't exactly say this is a bear market at this point, especially right with the Fed and pretty much all of the economic news we're seeing right now, all supporting the fact that there's really not much of a recession. Now, that doesn't mean there could be something, you know, some black swan event that we don't see coming, right? But as of right now, though, you know, there really hasn't been, other than this long-term bull market. The only reason why everyone's worried is just because the bullishness has been just kept going so long. There really aren't any economic sentiment indicators or any economic news indicators right now that are screaming right deep pullback right now. So I have a hard time calling it a bear market. I'll call it a neutral market right now. I would imagine anything that goes lower here will be bought right back up again. And again, you can definitely see these bears are trying to kind of you know, hook this thing in, right? They're trying to sink their teeth into this market right now. It's working for now. We'll see, of course, if they can keep this up for tomorrow. Most important thing we see is it's a range bound markets. Of course, what I'll do is I want to buy low, sell high, avoid the middle. But really what I'm trying to do now is once I see my range on the chart, I'm going to use the size of that range now, right, to find my levels above and below, right? I use that trading range to find my sell zones. I use that trading range to find my buy zones. And as always, right, we buy low and we sell high. Sell above the highs, right? Buy above those lows. So one of my main components on a range day, buy low, sell high, and avoid the middle. So I don't want to do anything right in the middle. You can see the S&P spent a lot of time here today chopping around inside of that middle. And the hardest part for tomorrow, if you're an S&P trader like I am, is going to be staying patient and really sitting on hands around that middle, waiting for a breakout so we can then fade that breakout and take it back up into that trading range. Now, you'll also notice I've also drawn in some of these what I kind of call expanding trend lines, right? They're kind of the opposite of what you would expect, right? You can easily see that trend line there, right? I think you can easily see this triangle coming in. And the triangle's really important because the triangle tells me to pay attention to the swings, right? And then, of course, we go up, back down, we go down, back up. But what's really interesting in this chart is that trend line right there and that trend line right there, because that gives me a very well-defined level of support. It gives me a very nicely defined right level of resistance. So I know where my levels of support are below. I know where my levels of resistance are above. What it really comes down to when it's a range market is momentum. Now, momentum, there may not be much momentum during the range, but what I mean is momentum during the breakout, right? For example, if I see a relatively small break higher and I get that moving average coming over, what I'll do is I'll just look for those buyers to try to buy the pullback, and I'll just simply sell into their stop losses and bring it right back down into that range. You can see an example back here, right? We go up, the buyers try to buy the pullback. When they fail, right, we'll sell it back down into that trading range. So the same basic pattern that we saw here, we'll use it over here, right? Same basic idea here. Now, there's a slight difference to this, though, if that was to really push higher, right? If it was to get into this secondary level overhead, right? That secondary level, 14 up to 19, now that's a pretty big jump, and that momentum's probably not going to be easy to turn, is it? So in this case, what I'll do is I'm going to wait now for those pullback, right, that pullback to try once, lower low, try twice, and then use again. What was the name of it again? It's called a nested failure, right? That nested failure pattern. And again, we'll wait for that nice signal candle and we'll sell it back down again. Does that make sense? So for example, as we go lower down to that trend line, moving average comes over, The bears, they come in, they try to sell off the moving average. Again, you know, breakout pullbacks are very, very common strategies for inexperienced, undercapitalized, and nervous traders, right? Like I was for the first couple of years of my career. We don't want to take that breakout pullback pattern, but we do want to identify where the pain point is, right? Where those sellers are going to start suffering, and we can buy into those stop losses going back up into that trading range. But if we were to really run, right, down into that secondary level, now that momentum's a little bit stronger, right? I'm not going to be able to be as aggressive this time. Now I want to let them try once, try twice, and go up from there. I think that makes sense. I think that's, you know, I don't want to say common sense because common sense isn't that common these days, right? But I think it makes sense, right? If it's a relatively shallow pullback, I can go after that straight failure, right? Literally buy into the stop losses. Again, just make sure the seller's coming up the moving average, okay? Or we go big pullback now. Now that momentum's too, a little bit too strong. Once, twice, just give those sellers the benefit of the doubt. You know, give those sellers the benefit of the doubt and then back up into that trading range, right? Same thing. We go up, one, two, fail back down in. Or we really go up, right? No, not anymore. One, two, and then back down from there. Stay out of that trading range. Now, we've talked about buying low and selling high. We've talked about how important momentum is during those breakouts. Let's talk about breakouts, though. What does a breakout actually look like? Well, for a lot of people, they look for a big, strong move higher for a breakout. But that was a pretty strong move higher right there, wasn't it? And that was a pretty strong move down, too. So strong moves are not enough to qualify a breakout. In fact, most of the time, strong moves tell me that rookies are probably going to be unrealistically, you know, confident on that breakout, and I should probably fade it, right, go against their stops. So if I see a strong move up, what would tell me now that I could safely call this a breakout? You got to hold the pullback. You got to hold that pullback and run, right? Run. You got to go. You got to show me you mean it, because if you can't, right, if you pull back and right, little wimpy buy off that moving average, I know exactly where your stops are. I also know the odds are on my side selling back down in, right? Not every trade's a winner, right? It's not. There will always be an exception to every rule, okay? But in most scenarios, right, over 100 trades, if you're going to buy this breakout pullback, you're going to lose money. Again, maybe not on one individual trade, but if you took, you know, 50, 60, 75 trades on that pullback over the next 6 months, that will be a losing strategy and your account will slowly die, right? Like a death of 1,000 cuts. That's what happens in trading, right? Most people don't, well, I did, but when I was a new trader, I lost a big chunk of money at the beginning of my career, making stupid, you know, just doing stupid things with news events, right? But the most important thing, though, is a lot of traders, they kind of bleed out. Right? They make some money, they give more of it back. They make it, they give more back because they're trading strategies like that. Now, once we do get a firm breakout, right? And again, what do we call this again? A one, two, three, right? Repeat after me. One, two, three breakout into what? Into hidden channel pullback. Say it again. One, two, three breakout into hidden channel pullback. It's got a little ring to it, doesn't it? One, two, three breakout into hidden channel pullback, right? A little jingle there. Whatever it takes to remind you of what it is. But again, I'd say one, two, three. Now, this could be a very strong move up, hold and go, or it could be very small, right? Up, go, and then jump. I really don't care. But we got to get a price. We got to get the market jump off that moving average. It's the jump off the moving average that makes it a breakout. Okay, same to the downside. Strong move down, good for you. Hold the pullback now, right? Can't do it, back into the range. If they can, now I trust you. Now you mean business. Mark up that low, mark up that high, right? Mark the low first, because that's gonna give you that hidden channel. And then of course you can sell off that hidden channel, right? Now, where's our targets gonna be if we do get that breakout? Because we might see a breakout tomorrow. Target here for the buyers, back up to retest these highs, right? That's your big target for the buyers. Where's my bear target? Bear target, kind of a messy down here, right about, you know, right about the next level, obviously, is back here at 72.5, right? 63. I would imagine, though, if they get that breakdown, though, Yeah, you're probably looking somewhere right about there, right? 3080, 3085 area. I would leave a runner down to that 73 area, right? But I wouldn't wait to take my profit off until there, right? And we'll talk more about that tomorrow as far as managing those positions tomorrow morning, right, in the trade room. So we know the market's a range. We know, right? We know we've got this this rectangle going back and forth, buy low, sell high. And again, what was it again? How did that little jingle go again? 1, 2, 3, breakout into hidden channel pullback. Now, guys, I've got hundreds of examples of those 1, 2, 3 breakouts, hidden channel pullbacks inside that free course. So make sure you grab that before the end of this video. Next up here, over on the Nasdaq. Nasdaq is pretty much the same song and dance as the S&P. So of course, if I look at the Nasdaq here right now, kind of zoom out on this, you can see where we are, right? The buyers will want to get their breakout and run back up to retest the highs. The sellers are going to want to get their breakout, yep, and they're going to try to get that low back at that 81.60 area, right? Breakout and run lower from there. So buyers definitely have a nice clean line of sight here if they can get this thing to break higher. The sellers, they've really got to show some strength, and then we'll see how far this thing can pull back as it goes lower. As you can see in the Nasdaq right now, Nasdaq has that range right in the middle. I'm going to use that Nasdaq range to find my buy zones, to find my sell zones, and of course, you know the drill, right? I want to sell as we go higher. I want to buy as we go lower. I've also got this beautiful, these trend lines overhead. And what's very interesting about this particular example of a hidden or kind of like an expanding triangle, I can easily use that one off the low. But the one off the high here, that's a big move. That's a big move. So I think what I'll do in this situation is we'll kind of give you one more wrinkle to this, right? So if we can get down into this area, same old thing, right? It's a seller failure, buy it back up. If we really tumble, let me zoom back in again. If we get these off of there, there we go, right? Clean that up. So you know where the range is here, obviously, right? If we really tumble and really run, now it's a 1, 2 and back in, right? This is the same thing. I'm not going to go into that much detail on this one because we just talked about most of this on the S&P, right? We go up, moving average comes over, buyers try to buy the pullback, we sell into their stop losses like that one back there. If it really runs though, right, up to that trend line here, now we've got to be careful, right? Now we got to be careful because that's a big, big move as we go higher. And because that trend line will put us well outside of that second range deviation, you know, I'm assuming they're not going to go right there right now, right? They'll probably be there later on. What I want to do is look for a little more conservative reversal pattern, which I call a crown reversal. We go up all the way to the trend line, right? It'll be a 1 try for the buyers, a 2 try for the buyers. But because that market will be so bullish at that time, I'm going to wait for a trap high on that. Trap highs, traps are my way of building in the potential of that breakout. You know, at that point, if we get this little strong move higher here, right, if the market really runs strong like that, these buyers are going to aggressively try to buy that pullback and run this thing out of this range here. I will anticipate that, even though it's a trend line up there, again, momentum really plays into, you know, how to anticipate the best way to trade a breakout. It really does. Right, that momentum is kind of the hidden jewel or the hidden clue of a range-bound market. And you wouldn't think that's the case because range-bound markets, they don't have momentum, right? That's the reason why they're range-bound. They don't have momentum. So momentum really is kind of that silent, right, that kind of quiet clue that we want to use here on those ranges. So again, just kind of recapping here, right, shallow pullbacks, failures, deep pullbacks, nested failures, again, let them try twice. As we go higher, you know, shallow pullbacks, right, for failure patterns. Really strong move here now. I'm looking for that nested right here on the NASDAQ because that trend line is a little bit higher there, right? And again, in this one, I want that trap high variation to avoid all of that bullish momentum. As we try to get a breakout here in the NASDAQ, again, I don't care how strong the original move is. What I care is how strong is the pullback and the jump off the moving average. That's all I care about. Okay? The strength of that original leg doesn't matter. What does matter, though, is can they jump off that moving average? And if they can, then I know I can rely on that pullback and I can buy that pullback off that hidden channel. What was it again? 1, 2, 3 breakout into a hidden channel pullback. Okay, so we know where they're trying to go higher here. Stay on the downside. 1, 2, 3 breakdown. Mark that low, mark that high. And we're selling, again, off the high of that hidden channel. Looking else on the NASDAQ here, yeah, there's not a lot more, right? There's not a lot more to talk about here. We're buying low, we're selling high. The depth of that move, right? The size and the strength of that breakout determines the specific type of pattern we're going to use. And as always, we'll look for that 1, 2, 3 breakout into hidden channel pullback. And again, we'll do all this together tomorrow as well. So that way you don't have to do this on your own, right? Come out and join me every morning in our trade room and we'll do it together. Over on the gold. Now, gold is probably the most difficult at first. It kind of looks like the gold now is a bear market, but I think what's happened is I think there's quite obviously some trend lines coming down here right now, and every time they try to get a failure, they were too close to the darn trend line, right? Just too close to it, and I think that's why we kept seeing them back off as the market tried to go back up into that trading range. We know right now here on gold, we have that range right in the middle. There is that bullish, right? That bullish tone before the range that would give this a bullish bias to it, but it's very difficult not to look at this market and see those lower lows and lower highs. You know, this is one of those times where I look at a chart like this and I say, okay, I know this is a bull bias to this range, but just looking at the chart right now, I don't think there's going to be everyone's going to see that channel. And so I have to be aware people are going to be piling on trying to sell here as we go, right? There are going to be sellers as this thing goes higher here. Okay, I think that's going to be the biggest thing for tomorrow. As it goes higher, you're going to see a lot of bears enter this market because, again, you can easily see that channel coming over. So that's one of the biggest concerns we have here right now. And really, that is easy to get around. It actually really is. So we know it's a range. We know we want to be a buyer down here, but we know we've got a lot of bear momentum. We also know we have this trend line coming down. In fact, you know, I'm drawing it off this little hidden channel here, right? You might even say, no, look, you could draw it here too, right? This could also be, right? That could also be the trend line right there. This could also be that trend line coming down too right here. So that could also be a little spot right there too, right? This little area could be an area of resistance. So if I just go out and try to find my typical failure pattern here, that's not going to work, right? Just because, again, you can see why those previous ones didn't work. Nobody wants to buy into that falling resistance. But we're underneath this range. We do want to go back into the range, though. Okay, so what's the best way to do it? Well, again, because we're so bearish overall, we want to let the sellers try twice, right? That's for sure. We want to give those bears the benefit of the doubt. Again, that's one big clue. A lot of obvious bearishness here. But the other big clue is the trend line coming down. So remind me again, guys, what's my favorite pattern to avoid buying into resistance? A trap. So put those two together, right? We want to let the sellers try twice because of the overall bearishness. But at the same time, though, we also need a trap to avoid resistance. Why don't we just put these two together, right? There's try twice and a trap. Let's do that, right? One try, two try, trap low, and go. What do we call that? We call it a crown reversal. And we have yet to see that pattern today, right? We go down, we go back into the range. Nobody wants that failure, right? You're back into the range. Nobody wants that one. No surprise that one failed. We go now slamming back lower, running back higher again, right? We're not going to try to pull back, not into that trend line. What's the best pattern in a range market? A failure, right? We let the bears try to sell it, and we try to buy into their stops. That's not a good trade. You're right in the middle, and you're again right into the range. So at first glance, you look at the chart and you go, what's going on? Why aren't they running it higher? It's because there's obviously some issues with these trend lines coming down. So two can play that game. If we don't want, right, if we don't want to buy into resistance, and we know there are bears who are likely to think this thing is too bearish to buy, let's hit them right where it hurts. Let's let them try once, let them try twice, avoid that darn trend line, right, and buy it up from there. That kills two birds with one stone. It respects the sellers. It also uses the most effective pattern to avoid buying into resistance. Now, pay attention to how I draw this up right now, because you can see I've got these as higher highs. Okay, look back in time here. You'll notice this one looks like, right, little trap. Doesn't that look like a trap right there? That kind of looks like a trap, but it's not. Why? Because a trap has to have a higher high. You've got to have a higher high right there to why? Because sellers want to sell high. They sell it again, and then that would be a crown reversal. Make sense? So when you see that little trap right there, that is technically not a trap low. It's not. I mean, it goes below a swing like that, but the only way a trap low happens is after we get a higher high, right? I've got to get a higher high to create that swing. Once I get that higher high, then I can get a trap below it. Make sense? Okay? This is a very subtle but very important clue in the price action. And by the way, these are the small details that we cover in our price action course, our intermediate class here at School of Trade. Our intermediate course is really one of the unsung heroes, because it really teaches all these fundamentals of what does an actual trap come from. It's not just a pullback below a prior swing, right? A good trap pattern. Remember, every time we see a new higher high, the lowest part of that pullback is the swing. We pull back, higher high, lowest part of that pullback, right, is the swing. If we pull back and run higher now, right, if we pull back and we don't go higher, is that a swing? It's not. It's not, right? Why? Because that does not become a swing until what? Until we get to a new higher high. Once it makes a new higher high, now that becomes a swing, and now we can use this, right, as a trap. So if I have, this happens quite a bit, right, where you'll see these moves, they'll run higher, right, they'll pull back, real deep pullback, they'll try to make a move like this, right, that right there, that's not a swing yet. That is not a swing yet, right? So a trap below that low, it's not a trap. It might be buyers trying to buy a low, but it's not a trap. A trap is going to come after, and I realize this might be, you know, kind of 101 stuff for a lot of you guys who are clients of mine, right? But for everybody else out there, this is, right, that's your trap right there. What's the key? Higher high, right? So what I want to see is, us go up, pull back, up. Bears now, try twice, trap low, and go from there. That kills two birds with one stone. Now, what if we end up back inside that range? Again, you know, we end up back inside the range. What do? We sit on hands. We wait for the move down, one, two, and we run back up, right? Or it gets clobbered, big move down, nested, one, two, back up. It's the same pieces. It's the same ingredients. We just use them differently. You know, like a chef, right, uses different food ingredients for different meals, right, or different dishes, whatever they call them these days, right? We use the same ingredients. We use the same patterns over and over again, but in different ways, depending on things like momentum, right, market structure, things like that, okay? So now we got a pretty good plan there. Now, let's talk about as the price goes higher here, right? Because what if this thing just rips, right? What if it just rips higher off that trap low and rips higher? Do I sell that here? No. Think about it this way. There's a big difference, and you'll see this right away. If the market runs up and goes sideways here, is there a lot of momentum at this point? No, right? That range has kind of squeezed out all that momentum. But what if the market just takes off and runs? Is there momentum now? Oh, yes, there is, right? And that momentum, again, is really kind of the unsung hero of a good range-bound strategy. So let's say, for example here, get rid of these here for a second, just for illustration purposes. Let's say we go up into the range, right? We settle in here right now. Now it's as simple as one, right? Simple as we go up, right? Buyers come over. Buyers, of course, try and fail, and we're back down right into that range. If they really break strong here, right, then it's a one, a two, and then back down in the nested failure pattern. However, if this thing really, right, if it really just rips higher, now the only way I can sell that is to use, what was the pattern again? A crown reversal, right? It's the most conservative, of all the failure patterns. It's a one try, lower low, two try, and then a trap high, right? Because again, you know now, you've got to get that lower low for that to be a trap. See, you're getting it. You know, you put one piece together, you know, one foot in front of the other. Every day you'll learn more with me in the newsletter, right? I'll give you a big shortcut as a client of mine, obviously, right? You can get it all in one place and we can do it all together, right, as a client of mine, or together every evening, right? Put one foot in front of the other with me tonight, right, on this newsletter. And hopefully tonight you're learning one more piece, right, of this puzzle here. So again, right, if we go up into that range and sit, right, it's a range-bound market. One try, two try, back in, right? Or big move down, nested, back in, right? But if it really runs through, you know, again, we run up into that range, up one, two, back down in, or, right, we really run through that range, now one, two, trap, and back in. Or, right, or it may go running right through, pull back to the moving average, and jump off the moving average. If it jumps up, then what? Yes, breakout. One, two, three, breakout. You're in, right? You're good. Buy the pullback. Okay, hopefully that makes sense. Okay, that's also a very important part of a range-bound market, right? If this thing just cruises higher here and says, what range, right? I didn't see any range. Keeps going right through it. We pull back to the moving average again. Right, gonna jump off the moving average there, find that new high, find that new low, right, and we'll buy off of that low. Momentum, right? Momentum is really the most important kind of the silent killer, right? It's the unsung hero of a good range bound strategy. Okay, you gotta respect momentum when it goes swinging back and forth here. All right, good stuff here on the gold. So basically, we're looking for that crown reversal, right? That trap low right now to avoid those trend lines coming down. Okay, we know what to do if it goes back into the range, if it cruises right through it. What if it pulls back and runs? Yeah, that can easily happen. It looks like the bears are almost there right now. So they run lower. They, you know, we got the measured move right here. So this measured move to me seems to be like the final spot. You know what I mean? It seems like, okay, this is about as far as this thing should go. It may go a bit further here, but if we get a strong move down and they can hold that pullback and get that jump off, yeah, we're done, right? We're done. Mark that low, mark that high. And again, you can see I'm not about to predict the breakout. I'm not going to do it. It's not a reliable strategy. Yeah, every once in a while, you know, I'll see somebody post a chart on Facebook or, you know, whatever, stock twits, and they grab this big breakout, right? And I'm thinking their time will come. Eventually, they'll have to pay that bill. You know, whatever money you make from trading breakouts right now, just, you know, don't spend the money, please, because you're going to be giving it back in 6 months, right, when the market catches up to you. You'll eventually learn that lesson. You'll eventually learn to pay the piper, right, on those breakout trades. So I don't try to trade the breakouts because they're not reliable enough. I wait for the breakout to hold one, two, three breakout, find that new hidden channel, and sell the top of that hidden channel. My next target now for the bears, as you can see here, right, for those bears is back down to retest that low at 46.2. So if they can hold that 1, 2, 3, that should be an easy sell. That should be an easy sell as it runs lower off the top of that hidden channel. We get a bull 1, 2, 3, I've been talking about 1,500, kind of joking around on 1,500 this week, right? Again, might not be 1,500 tomorrow, but I would definitely think that 95 area, those high 90s, is definitely in the cards here if these buyers can catch a bid for tomorrow as well. So guys, excellent job here today on the video. I hope you learned a lot. Hope you use this information to earn a lot tomorrow. Protect your capital on a Friday morning. I know Fridays are always one of the hardest days to stay disciplined. You know, the weekend's on the corner. Everyone's planning, you know, Thanksgiving right now, right? So, you know, don't get me started, right? I can already smell my aunt stuffing all the way from her house. So I'm definitely right. Discipline tomorrow is the most important thing. And again, next week, don't forget, next week, short week next week, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday next week, right, in the trade room, Thursday and Friday. You know, Thursday, of course, right, being the holiday, Friday being the recovery day, right, the L-tryptophan day, right, the Black Friday. I will not be waiting in line at the local Best Buy for my, you know, discounted television set on that Friday. I'll be recovering with family and friends. But that's the plan for next week, right? So don't forget, tomorrow morning in our trade room, every morning, 8 o'clock Eastern time, get registered as an advanced member, and I'll see you guys there tomorrow morning at the opening bell. If you're on YouTube right now, check out all the links in the description of the YouTube video. If you're on the blog at Sideways Markets, just scroll right on down. Those big blue and red buttons are there for you guys to get registered below the video tonight. And as always, if membership is not quite right for you yet, please make sure you grab that free trial. The free trial includes our free pass to our trade room, right? Our free trading course. Hundreds of examples of how we apply our favorite strategy to our favorite futures markets. Grab that free trial on the homepage, all the links in the description of the YouTube video. Call that toll-free phone number right next to my ugly mug. Use that live support tool if you got any questions along the way. And thank you so much for tuning in here every evening on this video. Get some rest. Enjoy the rest of your evening. We'll see you tomorrow morning bright and early. If not, we'll see you guys next time. My name is Joseph. Be well out there. Be nice to each other, will ya? And be there next time, guys. Adios, amigos. Bye-bye for now.